to use a sports analogy, which I never use, we're in the home stretch. We're almost there. So thank you for being here, for your time and attention this afternoon. My name is Mark Puente. I'm with the Association of Research Libraries in Washington, D.C. So organizations of all sizes and types, if we can add that into our description, very often struggle to find ways to assess organizational climate for diversity and inclusion. Leaders often search for baseline data. We had some discussion about that in the previous session for the sake of benchmarking, to justify resource allocation, and in order to create improvement strategies that are evidence-based with quantifiable metrics. So this panel discussion this afternoon will showcase a number of different approaches to climate assessment in use or in development. And the potential uses for the types of data those methodologies collect. The advantages and challenges for each approach will also be discussed. I won't say anything about them because you do have biographical profiles for them in your packets, but we have presenting today first Maggie Farrell, who is the Dean of Libraries at the University of Nevada in Las Vegas. So thank you, Maggie, for being here, followed by Kawanna Bright, who is a doctoral candidate in statistics at the University of Denver. Research methods and statistics, thank you. Okay, I stand corrected. And then our final speaker will be Nikhat Ghouse, who is the Associate Librarian for Social Sciences and Coordinator of the Diversity Alliance Residency Program at American University. So please welcome our panelists, and we'll invite Maggie to the podium.
Thank you, Mark. It's great to be with you this afternoon, and I know it's been a long, productive day, so I appreciate you sticking with us throughout the day. I have some apologies. So first, I've only been at UNLV since August, so there are some of my UNLV colleagues in the room, so correct me if I get this wrong. The other is I'll be talking about what we did at the University of Wyoming, and I think I saw Cass in the room. Thank you, Cass. So Cass, correct me if my memory is a little bit fuzzy. So today I want to talk briefly about some specific tools that that I've been a part of at two institutions, and why we chose those tools and what did we initially learn. And even though I'm talking about two specific tools, they can be applied to other situations. So first, at the University of Wyoming, we did a climate qual in 2009 and 2014. And Cass, I'm correct, you have not repeated it yet, correct? Okay, thank you. So the reason why we selected climate qual and the reasons why you would select a number of survey instruments is that you want to assess, obviously, but you also want to see how attitudes, opinions, perceptions are changing over time. So that assessment, as Mark mentioned, is building the benchmark and then measuring against that benchmark about how you're changing, hopefully improving. We also wanted to validate. So we had heard things through meetings and, you know, around the water cooler. And so having a survey tool helped us to validate what we were hearing. But more than that, it's the depth of the issue. So we know in libraries that sometimes the most vocal are the voices that we hear. So we wanted to see if what we were hearing, how deep that issue was, or was that an opinion or a perception held by a few. We also wanted to determine where in the organization. So were there patterns? Was this happening in one department, or was it organizational wide? Also, anything about perception, was it identifiable to groups? So if there was discrimination in the organization, what was it based upon? The last two, responding to issues and employees having a voice, is the reason to do a tool is a communication to the organization that you are hearing and listening to concerns that are being raised. So it gives employees an opportunity to voice their perceptions and what they are seeing in the organization. The reason why we selected Climate Qual at the University of Wyoming was that ability to benchmark, not only benchmark over time, but benchmark against other organizations. So how are we doing compared to our peers? And Climate Qual allows us to do that. The next was to work with experts. So the University of Wyoming is, at that time, it was only about 90 employees. And we didn't have the deep expertise in order to conduct our own survey. So this was a way for us to really connect with someone else who would know better how to develop an instrument and then implement it. And then also we had experience with ARL. So even though the University of Wyoming is not an ARL library, we had extensive experience with LibQual. So there was a confidence, a trust. And so what we learned, we did this in 2009 and 2014, and they were very difficult university periods. So it validated a lot of the frustration and anxiety that was happening across the university. Wyoming is an extraction state, so the recession hit Wyoming later than it hit most universities, and it hit it harder because Wyoming, at that time, 48% of their budget was provided by the state. So a 10% cut of a 48% budget was rather dramatic. And unfortunately for Wyoming, and give Cass a drink at the end of the day, because they've had future positions removed and budget cuts and so forth. So we knew we were doing that during a difficult period. It validated that, but it was also very frustrating for us because library employees thought themselves first as a library employee, and I don't think Wyoming is unique in that. And then, oh, by the way, we also are a state employee. And that's frustrating in terms of some of the policies that you could implement. So if people were frustrated about their salary, but the state provides limited tools for you to improve salary or to address either equity or addressing compression, then libraries were really stuck. So the good thing is that library staff and library faculty thought of themselves first as library employees. The downside of that is that you're stuck within a broader system. The benchmarks that we had demonstrated that we were not unique, that many of the problems that we were experiencing are problems that other universities were experiencing. So it gave us the opportunity to network with our colleagues, and symposiums such as this today are one way that we can connect with each other and work on collective issues. The last is action items, and unfortunately, I left within a year of the last survey, but the action items were specific. There were some professional development items that were implemented, and I'll talk a little bit more. So the University of Nevada, Las Vegas, we're fortunate in that the university has a number of assessment tools in place. I'm also fortunate that we have a position that's dedicated to planning and assessment within the libraries. So the university has a number of tools that we can use. And we were already using the Pulse survey on a biennial basis, in addition to some other tools. But we made some changes in 2018 that we've just implemented. So mostly I'll be talking about our hopes as we've done these changes. So first, our distribution change. So we found that we were surveying a very large survey tool every 2 years. And the survey tool was just long and people had survey exhaustion. So what we've done is we've broken the pulse survey into tiny surveys. So instead of surveying one huge survey, is that we're breaking it up into about five smaller surveys, and they truly are a pulse. Tell us what you mean about this. And we only have about six questions, so we're trying to be responsive. We're also trying to integrate other tools that other groups within the libraries need. So the pulse survey is working with our diversity and inclusion, it's inclusion and equity, thank you, Annette, committees, so that we're integrating some of the work that that committee is doing in with the main pulse survey. We do have some comparisons over time, so that's great. But this is what we're really focusing on, the leadership team within the library. We want to develop specific action items based on each survey. So what our initial considerations include is that we want to include many people within the survey as possible, and we want to have a discussion that's inclusive of the solutions as well. So it's not just the results coming to the library, but it's the results that are, coming to the leadership team, but the results are being shared throughout the library. We are still looking at university versus library. So what tools, what action items do we have within the libraries that we can utilize? And then also, how can we communicate those results to the university? We suspect some of the issues that we uncover within the library are really university issues. So we want to make sure that we are connecting our results, our work, on a university-wide level. The last is communication. So there needs to be a whole message around the surveys so that we're communicating why we're taking the survey, why anonymity is being respected and hopefully trusted, and we still have a lot of trust work to do with that. And then also, what are we doing? What action items? So each pulse survey will result hopefully in about four action items that we'll report on to the libraries, and then we'll come back and we'll look at the action items. So the action items need to be specific. So we're really working on the communication around the survey tool. So I'll give you just one sample. I know that you can't read this, probably even from the front. But it draws into our communication. So all of our survey results are posted within our staff website. And we have both the content, the specific results, as well as graphs that help people understand it. So by giving them a visual aid. We do strip out any personal comments. However, the personal comments are given to me in case I see a pattern with a specific individual or department that we can talk with. This chart, this sample, gives an example from 2016 and 2018, so we can see how well we are doing over a period of time, and then see where our gaps continue. So we're really excited that we have this wonderful tool that helps us. This is Tableau, by the way, if you haven't used it. And so finally, I'll just wrap up and say that the tools are, we have a number of tools before us, and there are a lot of good tools that can help us. And I would not focus so much on which specific tool, but that you have a tool and that you're using it and that you are measuring the pulse or the climate within your organization. That you're talking about why that tool is being used, the importance. And then you assess and act, and then you assess and act and continue on. So this is an example of how we have used it at the University of Wyoming, and the University of Nevada, Las Vegas. And I hope in your quest that you're as successful as we're learning through this process as well. Thank you.
No, it's okay. And we'll save questions to the end. Okay, Kawanna?
One day they're going to make podiums for tall people like me, so especially tall people with bent backs. So if I need to lean closer, please let me know. I'm trying not to hurt the bulging disc in the lumbar region. Yeah, not fun. First of all, I do want to point out that I am an example of a project that's sort of in progress and works, so kind of keep that in mind as you're looking at this. But my tool doesn't really have a name, even though I sort of self-named it when I called it Taking Aim, so you'll find out what that actually means as we go through this process. But it's a library diversity and inclusion self-assessment audit, which was actually created for a health sciences library specifically. So I was contacted because I was someone who had done work in diversity and inclusion within libraries. I'm introduced right now as a PhD candidate, but I was an academic librarian for 12 years, so I have background in both areas. And I was also cheap because I was a PhD student who needed money and could do consulting work, so let's just be honest. But they really hadn't done anything previously to try to assess their diversity and inclusion efforts, and they really wanted to do something, but they didn't even know where to start. So they, you know, went on the hunt, they found me. They really wanted to advance their efforts both internally and externally. So this was kind of a twofold process. And so my role was to create a tool that they could actually use that would actually give them both an immediate status in terms of where are we? We don't even know what we're starting, so the benchmarking idea was there. But also, how do we track ourselves going into the future? And then also look at this tool as a way to kind of keep track of just everything that's going on. So part of my process was to look at a couple of different methods, or in this case, frameworks or theories, to kind of help create this auditing tool. They actually brought to me the social inclusion audit. So anyone who is in Canada may have actually seen this, comes from kind of the public side of libraries. And they were really interested in this particular audit, and they showed it to me, and I said, it's great, it's just not for you. And that was one of the problems. It just wasn't something that was going to be easy for them to adapt without any background or knowledge of what they were using it for. But I did tell them that the audit itself had some really good pieces to it that I thought we could apply if we just kind of pulled that idea. So the social inclusion audit actually focuses on this idea of openness, intentionality, and inclusion. So I thought that was actually powerful. That kind of got turned into what you're going to see a little bit later in mine is more of like awareness and intentionality as well. But it was really good for guidance for me as someone who's coming from the perspective of, okay, they're really interested in this. How do I apply this to their needs? And then working with my friend over here, Nikhat. She's the one who does organization design or development work. And so she's actually one of the experts I was actually talking to help me review as I'm working on this audit, because it's not a single person's process. I cannot do that myself. She's the one, as she was reviewing it, going, you're kind of already applying this model. You might want to know more about it. So she sent it to me, I looked at it, and she was correct. I actually saw the possibilities of using the Galbraith model to actually, as a way to organize this entire audit, which is really nice because this process is about the organization. It's not just about a small group that's in the library. It's really about the entire organization trying to do something. So this is just a representation of the visible STAR model. There's a lot of information out there about it. You should definitely read up on it if you're interested in it. It's a very quick read. There's also a sixth category that doesn't visibly show up that does also show up in the audit, which we'll show later. You don't find that sixth until you actually read the entire STAR model. So my process was, of course, first interviews. So I interviewed key members of the library team that were working on this project, just other key members of the library. I wanted to truly understand what they wanted to do. What do you actually want to get out of this process? Not just what you have on paper, but what do you actually want to get out of this process? A lot of document reviews. I probably know more about their institution than they do at this point, because I had to review not only what was happening in the library, but what was happening on their campus to see what we could do with the external things as well. And then the expert reviews. So working with librarians and other research experts first to review the audit, make suggestions on wording. This included those back at the library. Is this sounding like what you really want to do? And that process really did take about a month and a half, 2 months to actually get through this entire process. And then, of course, piloting the model, the audit. So I worked with the volunteers from the library to test it out, see what they thought. We made additional changes in the wording to make sure everything sounded good, and then they were able to actually use the audit at that time. So I will show you kind of an example, and I apologize, this is hard to see as well. The final audit actually had 35 items that were put into six different categories, and those six categories did follow the STAR model, so that's how I was able to structure the actual audit. You would rate the items in two different areas, so you rate them first by status, and then you rate them by progress. And so this allows you to see, one, where you're at, and whether you're progressing as you go through each year, as much as you either think you want to progress or hope to progress. And so looking at this one, it's just looking at the strategy section here, and it just kind of asks questions like diversity and inclusion are explicitly addressed in the library strategic plan. Usually a pretty simple question to ask and answer. You can look at your strategic plan, see where you're at. And of course, one of the options for status is non-existent, which happens to be the case for a lot of strategic plans. And then also for your progress, non-existent. And that usually means we're not even thinking about it. We haven't touched it. All the way up to expert, which means that we've done this. It's integrated throughout the entire strategic plan, and we think about it constantly every year. So because this is not an easy process to think about in your head, there actually is a scoring guide to help people understand how do you score something as non-existent, how do you score it as initiating, what do those things different things mean. So that is part of the front part of the audit that is clearly, usually I tell people if you're doing this, have this right next to what you're working on so you can take a look at it again, just to get a sense of whether or not it describes what you're doing at your library. The reason there are so many categories is because it is a continuum. You are able to fall within those different areas, and it's not fair to tell someone they're either, you know, one or five. So there had to be options in between. And then in terms of the actual scoring, so this is where I come back to where the aim came from. So the social inclusion model had the idea of openness, and really what that turned into for libraries was awareness. It was really about, am I aware of D&I efforts? Am I aware of what we're doing on our campus? Am I aware of what's happening in the library? And then the intentionality. Are we intentionally approaching these things? Are we trying to address these things? And then the third piece I added is what I call measurement. Are we able to measure what we're doing? Are we collecting the data that we need to collect? And once we collect it, can we do something with it? And I think that was actually the bigger issue for the library. They have data, they have no clue what to do with it. And so they're staring at this like large stack of stuff, and they're like, what do we do? I'm like, oh, that's a bigger question than this consulting job right now. But what this shows you at the end, so this is actually a self-scoring audit, and it actually shows you at the end where you score in terms of awareness, intentionality, and openness. And you can come back and look at the ranges to see where you fall and where that actually means. And so you'll notice here for those three areas that you can fall within the little progress, the moderate progress, or the extensive progress area. And then in terms of where you measure, whether you're showing very little ability to measure things, or some ability, or a lot of ability. And it kind of allows you to see where you're at in the process. But then there's a bigger picture. So we talked about those six categories that were going on. So where are we at in terms of status? Where are we at in terms of our people? Where are we at in terms of our external factors? And strangely enough, that external piece, that sixth piece that was added, had the most questions for this particular library because of their environment, which they found interesting as well. but similar to what we score for the AIM, you're able to score this one from basically 0 to 24 because those are the number of questions that fall within that category. That's where the scoring comes from. And it helps you mark your progress and also your status as well. And what does that mean? And so if this is not scary enough, this is the scoring for the entire thing. And this is the piece they were really most interested in because they wanted to know where are we overall with our status for D&I. And so you're able to see here that the range is from 0 to 140 because of the number of questions we have here. And they were hoping to not be in the 0 to 28. They didn't want to be there. I can tell you they were there. Yes. They sort of knew that. It was a fear of theirs, but they hadn't seen it put into this format, so that was a little scary. But you'll notice here the categories have also increased because, once again, we're on a continuum and you have more options. But this gives you it shows them that they were selecting a lot of non-existent, non-existent, non-existent. That was happening for a lot of the activities, and that's what that 0 to 28 really equals out to. So in terms of implementation, they did actually apply this back in September. This recently happened. They're going to check again in September of this year because they want to wait a year. And we talked about that timing in between, and I explained to them that it's really up to them. It's up to how much they think they can get done, but I told them not to check every month. They wanted to check every month. I said, you're putting too much pressure on yourselves. You're talking about activities that take time and effort, and if you check every month, you're gonna keep being a little bit disappointed, and then you're gonna stop checking. So we kind of compromised on a year. We thought that was a good length of time. I did suggest after that, if they wanted to check after 6 months or go to 2 years, that was up to them as well. So it really comes down to where you see yourself falling within the audit. For the future, I do think this could be implemented in any library type, but I think it's especially good for academic libraries just because of the way it's structured. So, next page. In terms of immediate impact, it let them see where they were actually at in terms of their D&I efforts. So this went beyond us. We talked about it, we think we're here. It showed them this is exactly where we're at. It did allow them to also start creating a plan to address the gaps. Strangely enough, one of the questions is, do we have a diversity and inclusion plan? If you do not, you may want to create one. So that actually was a process for them as well. And it offers them now a way to track this. They're able to now go back in each year and say that, wow, we've made a lot of progress in this area, or we haven't quite progressed in another area. There's a piece of this that we don't talk about, though, is me reminding them that just because you didn't progress in one area doesn't mean you didn't progress with D&I. So I had to remind them of that as well, that this audit does not say that everything has to progress. It's impossible. You don't have enough time to do that. But you want to see progress somewhere within the audit. In terms of future impact, it needs additional testing. I definitely recognize that, especially as part of my program. it has the potential to be widely used, though. And so one of the things that I will be doing after I finish my dissertation is looking for other libraries that are willing to look at implementing this so we can actually do some validity testing on this, reliability testing, to see if it actually is something that could be applied a little bit more globally. In terms of strengths, it is easily adapted. Once it's actually in place, it's really not that hard to actually make some changes to wording to make it fit your institution. So if there are certain titles of diversity offices, things like that, you can actually just make those slight changes so it actually works. It's self-scoring, which is the beautiful part, so you're not adding anything up. It does it for you. Can be easy to complete. I'm going to explain that once I look at the shortcomings as well. It does offer longitudinal tracking, and that was important for them as well. Shortcomings. Needs further testing in terms of whether it's going to be applicable across different institutions. It can be difficult to complete. And I know I just said it could be easy, but so let me explain this. If you have someone in place who's already in charge of your D&I efforts, who actually understands your organization and is already doing that work, that person by themselves can probably complete this audit by themselves. If you don't have that, which most of us do not, you have to find the people, and I think we heard a little bit of that of other places, so have to find the people to do this. You have to find the people who have the knowledge to complete the audit. That can be a difficult task, because then you're relying on multiple people, and then you're also back to making sure everyone's interpreting everything the same way, which is why there is a scoring system to explain how to interpret. But if you're in that situation, it's not just a process of we're gonna sit down and do this, and it's done. It's a little bit tougher to do. It does require buy-in from the administration, not only for the initial implementation, but also for the follow-through. This is not designed to be done as in we did it, we know where we're at, and we're done. There's work to be done after this. No one's going to be an expert across all of these. That's probably not possible. So there's going to be work to be done. And then also the results can be seen as negative. And that is a concern for any organization that's starting out from the base like this organization was. They knew going in it was going to be low. They didn't like seeing the number showing that they were actually in the smallest category. I was still there though to talk to them about that and explain that it's actually not a bad thing. It just means you have work to do. But you want to be careful. You don't want someone to get discouraged by seeing a number, because we all know what it's like to fail a test. And that's how they felt. They felt like they failed a test. Well, sometimes you fail a test, you just have to study harder and pass it the next time. So let's talk about my comps sometime. So it was very important that I explained to them that I didn't want them to see their low score as a negative thing. It was not a negative thing, because they were taking a very positive step towards figuring out what they wanted to do. And that's it.
Okay, so how loudly do I, okay. I can back up? Yay, all right. Good afternoon. My name is Nikhat, and I'm the Associate Librarian for the Social Sciences at American University. What I wanted to cover today was when I was asked by Mark to talk about assessment and organization development, and I turned to him and said, but everything about OD is assessment. And he said, well, talk about that. Okay, I'll talk about that. So what I wanted to do is give some context to what organization development is when I talk to people about OD, and that is the unfortunate acronym. I get a lot of different definitions for people, so I wanted to sort of have the same page on what organization development is. And organization development is about helping individuals and organizations move forward in a change process and using interventions, actions. So an example I'll use throughout is yesterday we spent 8 hours, I think, with two external consultants who work in organization development, Judith Katz and Frederick Miller. And they work with Fortune 50 companies. And they've done so for, I think, a combined 80 years. And the model I'm going to discuss is, I will revisit the PATH model, and another one that is a precursor to the PATH model. But organization development is all of these things. It's change management. It's looking at your culture to change an entire system, the whole system. Some of the work that we do is not just going in to look at how we can get, say, library faculty to understand a change process or move into a strategic change, but to get the whole system involved and to get the whole system to be a part of that process and move the whole system forward together and continue in that progress. So when we talk about OD, it's all of these things, including organizational culture, process consulting, which I'll explain in a bit, teaming, group dynamics, working together effectively in teams. Not a problem here. And it's a process as well. Everything, and I think that's one thing I've learned in the last few years is when I ask questions, I'm asking questions about process. And one of my colleagues actually came back to me and said, you know, I realized when you were questioning me, you weren't challenging me. You're asking me what's the story behind the story. And I think that context actually will help an organization get everyone on the same page and then begin a forward motion. And of course, diversity, inclusion, and coaching for leadership and for colleagues and facilitation is obviously inherent to that. So I talked about a change process and I talked about developmental change. So that's looking at tools that will help an organization. So much of what Judith and Frederick did yesterday was involve all of these introverts. Hello, hi. Involve them in the change process, and not as bystanders, but as individuals willing to engage in understanding that this is not just a change that I must do, but this is a change that we must all do. And without all, it can't move forward. And so the intervention that they did, the activity that we did, was an actual large group intervention. And so that activity, all of those activities, accumulation of those activities, is how we move the field, in this case, forward into engaging in diversity and inclusion in a constructive manner, in a productive manner, and in an understanding that is forward moving. So we can leave here, and we all have action steps. We all have decided two or three things that we're going to take with us, that we're going to take back to our organization, that we're all going to do individually, personally. We've changed, right? And then that comes from the very first word, hello, right? It also, so this change process can also help a current organizational culture. We are where we are, and we got there because of entrenchment and of not acknowledging our differences and not engaging in those differences, right? So as we move forward, we begin engaging in that, and we use organization development consultants to work on the mindset of colleagues and work on the mindsets of each other and to have those conversations to, again, keep going. So process consulting, so Judith and Fred are process consultants. So they look at an issue, they looked at the issue with Mark, for example, about or diversity and inclusion, and they provided an intervention. And they did so in collaboration, more than likely, with Mark. He provided them information about this organization as the field, as an organization, and he provided the context for them to do the work. So in process consulting, it's always based on data, so assessment. And process consultants can both be either external to a system or internal to a system. So I know I have colleagues here who are internal consultants to their university library, for example. And external to the system, and they're able to see the perceived problem and work towards a common understanding and of the problem before working jointly on with the organization and the leadership to identify. There's both the perceived problem, which leadership sees, but leadership can only see so much. Being at the 30,000 feet, you see what you can see, but you don't necessarily see down to level, to down all the levels of a system. So one of the processes of data collection, the first step would be to gather enough information from every level of the system. And I think that is something very different that we're not used to. Instead of just going to the leadership and asking, what's the problem? Okay, well, let me solve that. It's more involved, and it engages different levels of the organization so that that everyone has a voice in the problem and addressing the problem, and everyone therefore can have a voice in seeing a solution. And with most organization development consultants, they don't do their work and leave. They do their work and they come back and they check in and they reassess and they go through the action research cycle and engage in continuous development. So this is the PATH model. How many of you have not seen this? Okay, all right, not too many. So this is the PATH model, or the formal title. I've been calling it the PATH model, and I think Katz and Miller call it the PATH to inclusion. So the formal title is the PATH from exclusive club to inclusive organization. And you can see that there are two vertical axes and a horizontal continuum, and then a cross section. So when I first saw this model, all I wanted to do was put a sticker on it. And I wanted to say, the organizations that I'd work at, I wanted to say, we are here. And so I actually did that. I did a poster session and I gave people stickers and said, if you identify as a population of color, please put a sticker on here. And if you identify as someone from the majority population, please put a sticker on here. People took almost 10 minutes to decide. And this was a difficult question. And the question I put to them was, library science, how inclusive is it? And it ran the spectrum. Populations of color were near the point of blue, and to the left, and the majority population were also near the point of blue, closer to the center of the intersection, and to the right. And what I wanted to do was offer an awareness. I couldn't do OD consulting for a whole field, right? But I wanted to offer awareness of where we are, where the disparity is, and it's that it's not just out there, it's in here. So with that in mind, I'm hopefully going to turn this into an article in the next year or so. Now that I've said it out loud. You and me both. It's on my annual review, it's terrible. So we spent a lot of time with this model yesterday, but I'm going to go into stages of the path to inclusion. So I'm going to use an example. Judith and Fred did a spectacular job of this, but the example that I use is an exclusive club. An example of that would be the Jim Crow laws that occurred in American history. And as a history major, I went to the historical context. So moving forward, an exclusive club is Jim Crow laws in the United States history. There was a clear divide of who had access and who had no access. And it was actively, intentionally laws that excluded African Americans from almost everything, right? So moving forward would be 1954, the Topeka versus Board of Education being struck down. And the law on that year changed. But that was the first step. A law changed, not necessarily a mindset, and not necessarily other laws that hampered this history, right? So even though the laws changed, it became passive by default, so that would be the next stage. And then we moved into symbolic differences, where there were a few who would open door to see to those who were different and those who would assimilate into the majority. And then there were also those who became pioneers, and they talked about that yesterday, or champions, advocates, mentors. And then we come to that cross-section, that tolerance and critical mass, where you tolerate the differences, and it's a challenging period where you're questioning the old ways of doing things, but you don't necessarily have new ways in place to change that. And then the dominant culture at this point may feel threatened, not unlike today. So the next stage is welcoming, and you move towards tolerance to accepting differences and recognizing barriers and asking questions about everything. And I think that's where we are in library science today. We're asking questions as to why we're not involved as more. Why aren't populations of color more in leadership? Why aren't populations of color being retained? And then finally, an inclusive organization. An inclusive organization isn't an end goal. It isn't a checkbox of, oh, I have every population of color in my employ. I'm done. It's more of an understanding that inclusion is an ongoing process and that it's a goal. It's continuous. It's like learning. You could stop, but why? We're always going to be, as library science, as librarians, we are always learning. And inclusion is the same thing. So the next part is part of the multicultural organization development model by Jackson and Holvino. And they talk about the elements that might have to be addressed to change, in this case, the issues of diversity and inclusion. So if we look at these pieces at an organization level, library science is steeped in whiteness, right? So if we look at mission and structures and roles and policies, and additionally, I would add tenure guidelines, annual reports, job descriptions generally, and also internal hiring processes. All of those are, whether intentional or not, they're exclusionary for populations of color. Okay, so in the long run, exclusion in libraries is passive. It's present. And for populations of color, it's very visible. And there's no intentionality of this inclusion, but it's still in place. And the effect is the same, since the reality is different than our documentation. We say we're inclusive, but our practice is still exclusion. And I think this has a significant impact on retention. Retention is going to be a significant, continuous issue if we aren't going to change these policies. And I think about the generations, and I work with new librarians, and you know, I've been a librarian for 18 years. I worked at, I know, I hate saying that out loud. And I've seen a lot of different experiences, and I've talked to a lot of librarians of color, and they're impatient. The younger generation, and I can't believe I said that out loud, the younger generations are impatient. And that back door, they're going to use it if we don't do something, if we don't change, if we aren't going to be inclusive beyond name, then this room will look the same. Thank you.
So those of you who unfortunately were not at the pre-conference session yesterday, there's plenty of literature that's going to be shared, or that I think already has been shared on Google Drive, on our Google Drive folder. So I encourage you to seek those materials out. They're very accessible. They're wonderful. I've had the good fortune of seeing the facilitators for that work in a different context and not working with librarians. It's terrific. We have plenty of time for questions and discussion. So I'd like to invite anyone who has a question or a point of discussion for any of our panelists or related to the topic, related to assessment and diversity, equity, and inclusion, to please come to the mic. And please indicate who you are, from what institution you're representing, and what your question is.
Yes. Hi, I'm Robin Miller. I work at the University of Wisconsin, Eau Claire. I work at a relatively small institution in comparison to many of the people in this room. It's about 11,000 FTE. And also, it's an institution where, in order to get the chancellor and the administration's attention generally, information has to, we find, or just through observed pattern, has to usually relate directly to the student experience. So, and there are lots of obvious reasons for that, related to retention and certainly to, you know, tuition dollars and the idea that we're in this market where we're competing for students' attention. But when I think about that situation juxtaposed against a relatively small, although very homogeneous, white library that definitely has the climate issues that you've described surveying for, I wonder if you have any advice about how any library that is sort of struggling against the tide of, what do students think about it, and that mentality, how a library can get administrative attention for either resources or even just, you know, thinking about how to improve the climate in the library once we have this data. Like, how do we act on this data if our administrators have only sort of a rhetorical response, but not necessarily a resource-based response?
Yes,
good. That's good.
Thank you, Mark. So as the dean up here, I guess I get that question. So because we were briefed today, we didn't talk very much about university-wide, but there are probably other answers in the room, so if somebody has a really good response to that, I'm sure all of us would enjoy hearing it. I think it goes back to the strategic plan, so tying your strategic plan to the university, tying a specific action, mission goals to the university goals. Mm-hmm. So I can tell you at UNLV, which is the most diverse student population in the nation, when we talk about diversity, inclusion, equity within the libraries, we're also linking it to our student population. And we know that it's not only librarians and staff in the library,
do not mirror our student population, but we also need to be aware of what we are digitizing, what our collections are. Ooh, there we go. So that we're reflecting the student body, not just in personnel, but also in our collections and our services. So I think if you can link it back to the university's strategic priorities, and then also show how the library is solving the university problems. It's not just a library problem, but it's a university problem. The other strategy you can employ is the use of student groups. So what are the students saying about it? So I know as an administrator that the provost expects me to ask for more resources. That's sort of my job. She knows that I will say, we need more, and I am in competition with every other dean and unit across the university. However, when a faculty member, or in this case, a student, says the libraries need more because it will help me as a student, that might be another way to get the attention of other administrators. I hope that helped, but I'm sure there are other ideas in the room.
Yeah, I was going to suggest that maybe some, are you following up on that? Not to that, okay. Well, I don't know if anybody, I know my colleague at ARL, Sue Boffman, is in the room, but of course thinking mostly about larger institutions, but not all of them, who have gone through the LibQual or LibQual. I say LibQual because we don't work in libraries. Anyway, so LibQual and ClimateQual and understanding that, particularly with respect to ClimateQual, you know, there's a threshold, so the organization has to have to ensure anonymity and what have you. There's a certain threshold in terms of numbers, but the statistical tie between service quality, between commitment, an organization's commitment to diversity, and perceived perceptions about student satisfaction with library services. There's a significant correlation there. So, am I voicing that correctly, Sue? Yeah. Okay. So.
Well said. My question is for Kawanna. My name is Laura Spears. I'm the assessment librarian at the University of Florida. And I wish you would clarify for me who your participants were exactly. Maybe I was having an ADD moment, but because I wondered if there is some thought about appealing to different stakeholders to complete that very same audit. Thank you. I like your work.
Thank you.
Oh, yeah. Oh, there we go. There. Okay. So the participants really were just that particular library. So the audit was intentionally created for, well, as I mentioned, if you have one person that understands the organization, they could complete the audit by themselves, in theory. That is not actually what happened at this organization. They had what they called a diversity team, who were from different staff members, administrators, librarians from different areas of the library who worked together to actually complete their audit, which worked best for them. We did talk, though, about this idea of having others outside the library come and complete the audit, but the first one was not intended for that. It really was just for them to start with. While I was there, though, I did speak with other constituents on campus to find out what their thoughts were about some of the library's efforts for D&I, and I was able to include that in a report to the library, letting them know whether or not they were being perceived the way they thought they were being perceived, as whether or not their D&I efforts were aligning with what the university was doing. And what we found was that everyone else was saying they wanted the library to do more in those areas, and they didn't understand why the library wasn't doing more with the D&I areas. The library was wondering why people weren't asking them to do more with the D&I. And so we got a sense of the silos, which I think we all recognize that most of our organizations are siloed, our institutions are siloed, and libraries within themselves are very siloed. So what we discovered was that they actually had disability services inside the library, but nobody from disability services had told them that the equipment being used for the library was so out of date it couldn't be used anymore. And to me, that made absolutely no sense. I'm like, disability services is a tenant in your building, and no one has told you that your equipment is out of date. How is that possible? And so that was kind of that disconnect we saw between what was really going on and what they had access to and what others saw them doing and the fact that nobody was talking. So I wanted to, in many ways, try to do a separate audit, but unfortunately I wasn't paid for or given time to do a separate audit that would look at the external grouping. I would love to have had faculty do one, students do one, the local community where they're located, they have a huge public population that comes in. It would have been nice, and their public population, like many, looks nothing like the population that's running the library. Yeah. And that was actually pointed out as one of the major issues they have there, is that they don't look anything like their student body, they don't look anything about like their public who come in. I would have loved to have been able to do that as well, but that would have taken a slightly different study to be done. Does that help? Thank you.
Hi, my name is Arthur from Boise State University, and my question is also for Kawanna about the audit, which I really hope we can talk after this, because my graduate work is actually creating a diversity audit for academic libraries. So
you can have it.
Perfect, I'll take it. So my sort of question / thought is I'm really happy to see the sort of the scoring rubric that you came up with. Mm-hmm. When I was trying to come up with mine, I was looking at just basically what were people publishing, like in their documents and their mission, their value statements, all of that, mm-hmm. but also looking at the university-wide, like what's the university doing on a university-wide scale and how is the library playing a role in that, mm-hmm. but also looking at state legislators, and I went really generally. My question is, where do you see this going forward? I know that you said that the scoring kind of gives libraries a view about where they're at, mm-hmm. But when I looked at it, I noticed that maybe like schools that scored low, maybe in LA, mm-hmm. had a little bit different demographics than a school in Iowa. Mm-hmm. So what kind of recommendations do you give, or did you give that university, saying here's how you can improve it based on their current demographics, based on what they're already doing? One of the things I've noticed is that schools in very, like LA, which has a very large Hispanic population, mm-hmm. they weren't necessarily so proactive about diversity initiatives because it was probably already built in as part of, that's how the city's built. Mm-hmm. So so what kind of recommendations do you give to a library based on their score while also taking into consideration where they're located geographically and who works there?
And actually that was one of the first things we talked about. What this does is show you where you may have work to do. It's still up to you as a library to decide where to start doing that work. And so one thing we talked about was looking at the results and then aligning that with our population. What are we actually dealing with here? I will say, though, that the audit itself, if you look at the questions, is built in a way that's general enough where even if you are in a high public serving institution with HSI that's really high or APSI that's really high, you will still score about the same as anyone else if you're not doing certain things that should be done anyway. So if you're not integrating something into your strategic plan, that's a problem, regardless of whether it's DEI or something else. It needs to be in your strategic plan, as you were mentioning. So in that way, it's going to be universal. But it's also why I do talk about needing to be tested. I would love to test it in a different environment. I'd love to see it in an environment that has a higher population of staff of color and librarians of color, just to see if there is going to be a distinction there. I'd love to see it at a small liberal arts college to see what it looks like there. I'd love to see it at an institution that focuses more on science and technology. I think it would give us a sense of whether or not it actually does apply across, regardless of those different types of communities, because that's really what you're shooting for this type of instrument. You want something that, no matter who completes it, if it's an academic library, doesn't matter what part of the country you're in, doesn't matter how many students you have, doesn't matter how many faculty you have, if you get a score that falls between 0 and 28, then you would have gotten that score regardless of being in Florida, in New York, in Texas, anywhere else. So, but it definitely has to be tested for that exact reason. Yeah, because I have no way of guaranteeing that, especially since I built it for a library that is in actually a very diverse community, even if the library itself is not. So yeah, but you are absolutely right. So, and I definitely would love to talk to you more about what you're up to.
Right, thank you. Other questions, comments? We needed the espresso bar. Is that what's going to happen in the... Okay, well, we will wrap things up. We have a little bit of a break before our reception, which is going to be in the same venue where lunch was being served, and breakfast and lunch. Let me just, a couple of reminders. Yes, it's in the Stars Room starting at 5:30 p.m., so you have time to catch up on your email. We reconvene here tomorrow with breakfast starting at 8 o'clock and with two programs, one dealing with microaggressions in the Galaxy Room, and the other entitled Identifying and Deconstructing Dominant Privilege in Libraries and Archives in the Universe Room. Also, a reminder that we do have the post-its, the large flip chart post-its with the topics for the unconference. So again, this is not committing you to anything. We're not going to check your name and registration at the door, at the table, but please indicate, sign up for a round one topic and sign up for a round two topic, and that will help us get organized around those discussions tomorrow at the very, very latter part of the day. Okay? So any questions? I thank you for your time, for your attention. It was a packed room, and let's thank our panelists again. Thank you.